Thank you for catching the replay of day 16 of 31 Days to Love Your Lettering. Today we are talking about flourishes with the calligraphy pen. Good afternoon! Okay, so those of you that have been here the past few days, if you have been experiencing connection issues, would you let me know that so I can try to troubleshoot some more? Hi, Janet. Hello from Germany. It's good to see you. Happy Friday, our last day of new instruction with the calligraphy pen. You guys have been rock stars with playing with the calligraphy pen because I know that there is quite an adjustment to getting used to holding it at that angle and to exercise your hand instead of moving your fingers. So I know that that's completely outside of our normal handwriting. So I wanted to say, like, great job, everyone who's been practicing. I've seen your samples on Instagram. Some of you have messaged me on Facebook with them. And so today we'll talk about flourishes, and then I'll also get into a little bit of tips and tricks in case of troubleshooting with those of you that might be struggling with the angles, because there's just a couple of little tidbits that I've kind of picked up throughout the week for that. And so those of you that have followed along, you know that my afternoon session, this 2:30-ish spot, is mostly demonstration. We'll do a formal introduction, do our demonstration, and then after the demonstration is over, I'll answer questions and answers. That way, those that can't stick around for too long can get that block of instruction and then pass on. But then those that have some questions that they'd like to see answered or further demonstration, you can stick around for a little bit more chat. If you prefer the chat during the demonstration, then our 9:30 p.m. session is probably more to your liking, but you're welcome to join us with both if you have free time. I never turn you away because I enjoy doing these demonstrations for you all. So hopefully our connection is holding out. As for moving the videos to YouTube, that is still my plan. However, I'm going to have to figure out a different way of filming for YouTube because I do not believe that the recordings of these periscopes are as clean as I would like to. I've heard some feedback from people that are getting a lot of static, so I'm going to work on something else for that. So we'll see. We will keep this periscope and we will figure out something for those that are interested in having the videos on YouTube as well. It is in my long-term goals. I don't know when it will happen. Certainly after the move, it's not going to happen this month. Hello, thank you for joining. So let's go ahead and get started. Thanks for joining. This is day 16 of 31 Days to Love Your Lettering, and today we're talking about flourishes with the calligraphy pen. My name is Lisa. I blog at creatively.com, looking at life creatively. And we are halfway through, we're on that other edge now of our 31 days, and it is an introduction to improving your handwriting and getting started with creative lettering. We're taking little tidbits from different pen types and writing styles and just kind of reaching the entry level of all those spots. So certainly in the future, we'll go a little bit deeper with different pen types. That's coming, you know, later this summer, things like that. So lots on the horizon once I get situated and settled with the move. So I'm going to go ahead and start with today's instruction on flourishes. I'll give you a peek at what I have as samples. And then for those of you that needed links for more information about this series, I'll show you that as well. Okay, so when we talk about flourishes, there's a few different things we'll talk about. Here we've got connections or the end of the word on our descenders, on the ascenders, and we'll talk about why you might use a flourish. Here are some other examples back here. And so we're going to not work on alphabets, we're going to work on words today. All right, so if you are new here and wondering where you can find more information for this series, if you go to creatively.com/loveyourlettering, you'll find all the information about this whole series, including an index, a link to the index of this all the different posts that are self-paced. You can find me on Facebook/Creatively, Twitter, Instagram, Periscope @Creatively, Pinterest, I am Creatively Made. There are lettering and penmanship boards up there, as well as a quote board for those of you that might be collecting quotes for your catch-up and practice days. You can find most of my old Periscopes on catch.me/creatively. And if you are looking for the post that lists some of the supplies that we use throughout this series, creatively.com/loveyourletteringsupplies. In that post, I go through all the different types of pens and things that we use throughout the series. And also, for those of you wondering, next week, brush pen, it is the Tombow Fudenosuke brush pen that I highly recommend for getting started with brush lettering. And I'll talk about that again at the end of today's broadcast. So with that said, we'll turn to a clean piece of paper and start today's. Okay. So a couple of reasons why you might want to use flourishes. Of course, number one is because they're pretty, but they also have a purpose. A flourished letter can help you make up for some spacing errors that you may have in your layout of your word art. So that's kind of the reason why we do the flourishes. So you are not going to flourish some letters in the middle of the word because it just wouldn't make sense to the readability. So you will usually flourish on the beginning of a word or the end of a word or on your ascenders or descenders so that it doesn't interrupt the readability of your word. So let's talk about some of the letters that can be flourished. A lowercase e is one of them, and that's one of the ones where it could help to fill in some space. Like, say you wanted something centered, but you ended up doing it a little bit too much justified towards the left margin. So you may want to add a flourish to that to make up for that spacing. So I'm going to start by writing the word the. Okay. So like say I didn't have enough room for the next word that I wanted to put in the piece, so I knew I was going to have to start down here, but then I was ended up with all that negative space. So I can add a flourish to this E, and it is a horizontal stroke. And it would help if my pen stayed. Okay, so pretend that there's not that space in there. So basically, you're just adding a stroke that kind of closes that in. Now, if I had started with this word, or this was the only word on the line, and I wanted to mirror that, I can bring this H, the ascender of the H, I'm going to bring it down to cross the T and to balance out that word. Okay, so this should have been a little bit thinner, but I kind of fudged that and had to go over. So here's one way you can flourish on the left side, you can flourish on the right side, depending on where it falls on your line, your finished work. So notice the flourishes are something that I added afterwards. I don't necessarily write them in at the same time that I'm writing the word. I'll usually add them towards the end. Okay, so let's talk about the descenders. Okay, so I'm going to write the word happy. Okay, so now we have two descenders next to each other. So I like to make them a little bit, so I'm going to lower one of them a little bit further. Okay, and now we've got another descender right next to it with the Y. So I'm going to add the flourish to the Y first because that's going to be the one that drops down the lowest. Okay. And now the P's, I'm going to end up coming around and letting them connect. Okay. So I've been using this pen a lot, so I'm losing the ink on it. Now, this one right here is not exactly what we're going for. If you remember when we were talking about faux calligraphy, we talked about what you want. You either want a thick and a thin to cross, or a thin and a thin to cross. You do not want thick and thick to cross because they're not very pretty. They end up looking a little clunky. So you want your thins and thicks to touch, not thick and thick. So to improve that, what I probably should have done is either brought this over to here so that it would cross on the thin, and then I could have come back around and crossed again. So the flourishes is a lot about practicing, and sometimes in order to get that more fluid movement, you may want to try with pencil first, and I'm looking to grab a pencil from my desk. So let's say if I wanted to do this Y over again, so I might practice going here and saying, like, okay, do I want to cross this way and back around? So you're just kind of getting some fluid movement. So you might want to do some circles underhand and overhand on a scratch paper just to get that motion with your hands, okay? I know that looks like a mess, but really what it is building those muscles, building that muscle memory for that those fluid lines that you're going to want to try, okay? So let's talk about, let's see, another one. I do flourish my S's a lot. So let's do another word over here. So I'm going to do my B, E, I'm going to bring the S down, and the T. And I'll add a flourish on that B as well. Okay? So, again, my pen is getting a little bit dry, so I've got some rough edges on my letters. You can always go back over those, make sure your pen is at the proper angle for that letter, and just go right back over those strokes. Trying to maintain the contact of the pen to the paper. Okay, so that would be a flourished S where it drops below the baseline. The baseline is that bottom line where your letters usually meet. Okay, so let's do a clean paper. Okay, let's do another word. So I'm going to write darling, because that's got lots of different letters that we can flourish. Okay, so now let's try a descender again. So I'm going to come over here and come back through that thin part. Okay. Now I could bring it up again, but I'm not going to. I like it just like that, the big O. Okay, so now on the ascenders, let's dot that I. On the ascenders, I can do these as well, add a flourish. And if I didn't want to loop over, I could just come back. If you extend that fine part a little bit, you can come back over like that if you don't want to do the loop. about another way to do these descender flourishes. Let's try another word. Another word with a descender. Okay. Purple. That's a good one. Okay. I've got... So now I'm going to come down this G, I'm going to bring it here, and then I'm going to leave it there, okay? I'm going to come back with my fine point pen and do that way, okay? Okay? So you can do your descenders after the fact. So after you've done your whole word, if you come back in and want to flourish but don't want to do it with the broad tip pen, you can come back in with your fine point and add it that way. And that will definitely add extra flair to your words. Because then, of course, now you've got a really good contrast between those thin lines and the thick lines of the calligraphy. Okay. So, thank you. All right. So, I'm going to do purple with a capital P. Okay. So, we'll talk about flourishing on a capital letter. So, I've got my basic P. So I know the words or the letters look unfinished because I'm leaving those kind of open for the flourishes. So I'm going to go ahead and add the L. Okay. Now I'm going to come back over here to the beginning, and I'm going to add a flourish onto there. And I'm going to go in the downward motion and then come back up to meet. Okay, so I've got my thick down, and then I did bring the pen. And this is something, it's easier to do with the marker, because if I was using a dip pen, it would not want to do that upstroke for me. So these might not apply if you're using a traditional dip pen calligraphy for calligraphy. And I can also add a flourish onto here. Trying to cross that thick into a thin. My pen is losing ink. Okay, and I'll come back up. Okay, so there we have purple. Okay. Let's do another one. Let's do love. Okay. So I've got my capital L. All right. I'm going to have to switch to a more inky pen. Sometimes I need to go over it to smooth it out a little bit. So now my V, I'm going to flourish by going, I'm going to start higher on that arm. Okay. And then bring the E over. And let's add the flourish to that. Okay. So again, I'm going to go back over and just smooth those out just a tad bit. There we go. Alright, so that's a couple of different flourishes you've got with a fine point pen or the calligraphy pen on the ascenders. On the descenders, again, you can go back over with a fine point pen. And you can add flourishes to the end or to the beginning of your words. So here, there. So this H can also, I can come back over here and add one there. Again, your markers, if they're newer, are going to be nice and juicy, and you're not going to have these scratchy parts that I have over here. Okay, so how's that? Any questions about flourishing with the calligraphy, flourishing calligraphy letters? Oh, that was yesterday's. So while you're formulating your questions, I wanted to talk a little bit about maintaining the angles, because I think there might be just a little bit of confusion. Capital J. Okay. Just jumped on. Thank you, Crystal. Okay. So let's do a capital J. So now I want you to watch the tip of this marker. Let's see if I can zoom in just a tad bit. Alright, so now I'm starting at a 45 degree angle, and it's a 45 degree angle kind of away from my body. So the pen tip is going to be held at this angle. Whether you're lefty or righty, it doesn't matter. This tip is always going to go in that direction. So if you're right-handed, you're probably going to position your hand a bit under the line. Okay, so, but the tip itself is at that 45, okay, so I'll hold it in this hand just a little bit longer for any of the right-handed folk to follow along. So what you want to be able to create is a broad downstroke and a thin upstroke. So, for my lefty girls, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to make that broad downstroke, but a thin upstroke. So you're going against the direction, You're going with the direction of the broadside for a downstroke. You're going with the direction of the thin side for an upstroke. So when we have those curved strokes, as you're entering into the stroke, it's going to be thin because you're traveling in the direction of that thin side. And then when you curve around, the angle of the pen hasn't changed, but the position of my hand does a little bit. But now you're moving with the broad side of the pen. So that's why you're getting a thick side. What you don't want to do is enter into the stroke and kind of move that same way. We do that for for black letter calligraphy or Gothic, but not for italic. For italic, the entry stroke is not going into the direction of the broadside. The entry stroke is actually a bit up along the path of the thin side of the pen, and then down. And then the exit is up again. So let's see, we're going up, down, up. So here's a different letter. Here's the letter A. So I'm coming down, I'm going up in the direction of the thin. So I'm not turning the pen to go up. I'm just changing the direction that I'm writing, not the direction of that nib. Does that clarify anything? Was anyone struggling with that? No problem, Cass. So, I don't know. I'm hoping that helps explain it a little bit better, because I think that there was some confusion over, like, your eye, you don't want it to look like that. Not for this type of lettering. you're looking for that. So your entry stroke comes slightly up and then down and then up again. You're welcome. You're welcome, Peg. So was that helpful? Let's see. Please remember, I'm left-handed, so it's not going to come smooth with my right hand. But for my, one of your problems is wanting more rounded edges. I'm guessing like on that side or here. Okay, so for my right-handed folks, is it going up? So I have a harder time keeping consistent pressure. The L, the I, the H, and the K really confused you. Was this a helpful explanation for that? Or maybe not. So let's try an A with the right hand. Bear with me. So I'm coming down, up, and then the stem. Yep. Okay, the upstroke at the bottom of your A. Okay, and Janet, you're lefty, Janet, correct? Or are you righty? So I'm going to do the A again. You're right-handed. Okay, so does it help to see? Okay, so let's say, and mine is not too smooth because I have a harder time placing the pressure consistently. Okay, so let's go over. Coming up there. So I have to go really, really slow with my right hand. Are you wanting this portion more curved or the exit of the stem? Because there's actually like just different flavors of the letter A, even in italic. Like you can have that more angled one. The up on the bowl. This part. Okay. All right. So for that, go back to practicing those curves that we were doing. You think you need a thicker nib or a better pen? Is yours a 2? Or smaller. Sorry, my right hand is definitely shaky. Okay, so for those of you wanting a better curve on the bowl of your A, go ahead and do lines of these strokes practicing. Okay, so that was our downstroke curve. Let me turn to a clean page. Or here's a spot. So to practice that curve again for your A. Okay, so you're going down and then up in the same along the path of the thin side of the pen. Okay, so practice the strokes that you want to see improved. So if it's this portion of the A, you'll want a tad bit bigger. The 1.8 is a little small for you to be able to see the difference between those thin strokes and the thick and thin. So if you go just a tad bit bigger, even a 2.3 or I don't know what size the microns come in. But so back to improving. So you see that this is technically 3 strokes. You've got, let me get a thinner pen to make notes. Okay, so if you have certain letters that you're wanting to improve and you have specific attributes that you would like to see changed, isolate those strokes. So we've got a downward stroke here. We've got the second one, which is down and then up. And then we've got our stem. So do a line of each individual. So I've got my starting. Okay. So, and then that next one. And you can make them touch or not touch. It's all doesn't matter.
Because it's really what you're practicing is the motion so that you build the muscle memory of that stroke, okay? And then the stem. So we've got someone wants a J, a B, and a D. Okay. All right. So does that help to break apart the strokes that are in the letters? And then concentrate on building the consistency of those strokes. Because I will tell you, learning calligraphy in a week is hard. I'm not gonna say it's impossible, but it's not easy. It's a lot of these techniques and things take a course of time of practicing those different strokes. Okay, so let's zoom out a little bit and let's go back to capital J, capital B, and capital D. And I'm just gonna write them so I remember J, B, and D. So I know it's hard, and that's why please keep in mind that the 31-day series was just an introduction. Each week of this course can really be hammered out into, 2 weeks or 3 weeks on its own. And I'm gonna try and work on that, okay? You need to unpractice the wrong way. Oh, yeah. That's break them down into strokes and practice the strokes and then bring them back together with the letters. When I first started learning calligraphy, we would do kind of a whole sheet where we would, your pen is in the death grip. Let it go. You gotta loosen up. So we would make a whole sheet of like a line of the first stroke and then a line of the second stroke, a line of the stem stroke, and then form a letter and do a line of the letter. So you can certainly go back to that. Okay, so now capital J. I'm gonna start with the stem into the descender. Okay, so I'm gonna come down here and go there. Now the second stroke is going to come from top and come down. Okay? So you can come in more with the J as well. It really depends on what, and that looks like a G, doesn't it? Goodness. All right, let's do this again. Okay? But really depends on let's get a word. How about that? A word will help us make it make sense. So there's a J. Sorry, pardon my sniffles. Okay, capital B. No problem, Karen. Did that help at all? So you've got that stem stroke and a bit coming up on the tail, and then you've got a downstroke here. Okay, so let's try B. And we've got a stem stroke. And then we're going to bump out those. And now the J and the I, this part right here. And I would have just ended up there. It wouldn't have dropped below the baseline. Your J was not looking like one. Yeah, so the I is going to stop at the baseline and the J is going to descend below it. Okay. Calligraphy is hard. Okay, the B with the right hand. I can try. As long as you guys extend grace on my inconsistency with the right hand. All right. So I'm going to start with the stem. Do the bowl. And again. Try that again. And yeah. So that's looking a little bit squished. It's kind of looking a little more gothic almost. Did you need to see the J? And I knocked down the tripod. Hello, Lisa. Okay, let's try the J with the right hand. Okay, so the stem into the descender, and then I'm going to come in and do that as a second stroke. And if, there we go. Okay. So I went up because with the left hand, I was actually pulling the pen there. So I can go up there, but with the right hand, you may come in with the second, with a second stroke there so that you're pulling the pen instead of pushing it. Does that make sense? Hopefully that makes sense to both my right-handed and my left-handed friends. Okay, so now a D is going to start very similarly. You're going to start with the stem, and mine is not very straight. Okay, you're going to come here with the bowl, and I'm going to go back over just because that was really rough. Okay, and then you can come here like that. So for my lefties, okay, you're going to come down, you're going to go down, and over. So, I'm getting left and right hand workout today. How's that? So, are those helpful for those letters? You're so welcome. So, and you can do it at more of an angle, like we talked earlier this week. The italic alphabet can range anywhere from kind of being pretty vertical to a definitely more pronounced angle. And the capital T. So let's do, so this will be harder for me to work at the angle. Yeah, so I'm not very smooth there. Okay. All right, the letter T, capital T. Okay, and that one is going to, there's a couple ways you can do it. You can do a very straight stem and then come back over like that. Or if you prefer, like that, that can be used as a T. You can cross, you can cross that stem a bit more as well. You would choose your style based probably on the overall piece that you're working on. So, like, if I was writing the word that, like, so for me, that would be a capital T in the word the. Is that helpful? I know you guys are trying things, because when I don't see any questions or anything, I figure either my connection has completely dropped off or you're practicing right alongside me, which is what I hope for you to be able to do. So every once in a while, you gotta let me know you're still there. And send me on the right direction if I'm going off in the wrong tangent. Okay, so there was our J, our B, our D, capital T. It's a lot of it is playing with your styling. Yeah, I figure you guys are practicing. The foot on a letter confused you. Okay, so like here, or if I was, I think in my sample I had it here. Yeah, it's, that is all kind of depending on what the rest of your alphabet is looking like, what word you're putting it in, and what form of italic calligraphy you look at, because you can see it all sorts of places. How to hold the marker. Nice see there. Thank you. I'm very visual, too. My hand person has to stop and start, though. Yeah, a little bit. Create your own style. I think that it is, because I've taken the basic principles and then I just kind of add my own flavor to the finished writing, and you develop a style over time. Kind of you grab the rules to begin with, but then as you get more comfortable and find those better positions, It is. As for the right hand is needing to stop more and start more, it really depends on your writing utensil. Because those of us that are left-handed, we're going to stop and start more if we're using a dip pen, just because it does not have, it doesn't give us the freedom to push the pen that we get with a marker. But you'll see when we do brush lettering next week that it's actually the lefties that'll probably have to stop and start more, and the righties will have a little bit more smooth time with that. We'll see. I don't know. I think it's challenging whether you're right-handed or left-handed when you're first starting. You've lost your voice, or am I? Yeah, I'm kind of losing mine because my little one is sharing. Which watercolor pen is best for the lefty? You're using calligraphy with an ink barrel. Okay, like one of these, or one of these. This is a lot of stopping and starting because you're loading the ink with that, or with the pens, you can only go in that downward motion because the ink is going to flow from the bottom like that. So for me, left hand, with my calligraphy pens, like the old or fountain style pens. Ooh, sorry. I actually have to shift the paper 90 degrees from me so that I can get the right angle. And I don't know if you'll be able to see this. This pen is not loaded. Oh, goodness. Sorry. Let's see. Ah, yeah, we're empty there. Okay. Sorry. But, for working with this type of pen, I have to change the orientation of my paper. So now I've not changed the camera. The camera is still in my line of vision, and the page is like, this is the direction towards me, and this is the direction towards my hand that writes. So I would have to hold it this way. And of course it's not loaded with ink. Let me see what I can do here. Right, so I would just, yeah, I don't like the Schaefer pens, honestly. I've never had great luck with them. But I would need to find the orientation that gives me the angle. I bet you this nib is probably all junked up with dry ink. Okay. All right, so I need to work at the 45, but I need to work. And so this is where compensating as a lefty is no joke. And this is why I prefer to teach with the marker, because now I'm drawing in an opposite direction than Americans traditionally write in, which would be left to right. So let's write the word the right over here. And this is a much smaller nib. So I'm kind of writing away from myself a little bit, and then the word itself is coming towards me. But again, that's not how I typically write with a regular ballpoint pen. I would go across this way. So that's why, for the purpose of just starting, I really prefer the marker, because then you're not so much worried about the orientation of the paper, but you can concentrate on the angle that the nib is at and keeping that consistent. Sorry. Okay. So hopefully that didn't just completely throw you guys for a loop and add to confusion instead of clarity. Let's turn the book back to proper orientation. So that's why I either use the calligraphy markers or the parallel pens, because that allows me to keep the orientation, and it doesn't do that to me. It allows me to keep the orientation of the paper at my natural position instead of really altering it when I do, I don't know if any of you caught the lefty problem scope I did last month, but I talked about using the pointed pen with the left hand, and I do have to shift my paper 90 degrees for that. So as for beginning creative lettering and using a calligraphy marker or even the parallel pen is kind of a good blend for being able to use ink and a metal nib, but not having to change the orientation of my paper, because the tip is parallel, the ink will flow at this angle too. I know I squished it in there. Sorry, trying to find blank paper here. So here's the with the parallel pen. And this really gets very nice thin strokes. Yes, definitely. If you enjoy the calligraphy at all, the parallel pens are a great thing to put on your wish list. They're not too expensive. You can get a set of 4 different sizes for about $25, a capital G, sure. Like I said, if you have enjoyed the calligraphy at all or want to go further with it, I would highly recommend the parallel pens. It's a good blend of kind of the flexibility of a marker, but the beauty of an ink pen. So a capital G. I'm going to start with the bowl of the letter. Down, up. This is, because this is juicy, it'll kind of go through the paper, and this is not, this is regular graph paper from Staples. It's not calligraphy paper. They do put down a lot of ink. No problem. Skinner 4, are you Erin? I don't want to call you Skinner. Try now to write much too fast. Yeah, if you notice, my habit as a natural lefty is to go pretty fast. When I had to do 3 letters a day with a brush pen. Yes, Kelly, especially if you're right hand, please follow Kelly. It's Kelly at Kelly Creates, and she is doing 3 letters at a time with the brush letter for beginning brush. We're going to talk about brush pen next week, and it will be a very basic introduction to the brush pen. Janet, I am actually considering doing longer series with each pen, as I did the 31 days, which was a general introduction over a bunch of different pens. Now that people are adding pens to their stash, I was considering doing a few weeks at a time with each pen to talk about different styles within that pen. But unfortunately, that is going to have to wait until this summer once I'm completely settled in the new house. Yes, because I know that using the calligraphy pen this week was a challenge, because it's a lot to learn with the orientation of the pen. The O. I'll get to an O in just a minute. So I do want to help encourage you guys to keep trying. We'll talk about spacing the words at the very, I think it's the last week of the series, where we talk about combining letter styles for word art. So I don't want to leave you high and dry with the calligraphy pen after this series, because I know it's a lot to get started in just 5 days. And so I would rather spend a little more time with each type of pen, and in coming months go into longer series with each pen after doing this introduction. So hopefully that is on the horizon. I would love to say early summer. We'll see how quickly we can get settled in the new house. Annalise, can I just write one more word or one more letter? Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and use the parallel again because it's a good size. And sorry, I've got a toddler on my lap, so I'm trying to hold her. So the O, couple different ways to do it. So we've got our downward curve and then another downward curve to meet it. So it's not perfectly round. It's a little bit of an oval. You can do it a bit flourished by starting over here on that second curve. And I'm not going to put my hand over that. No, that's okay. Once we get towards, I figure if we do the demonstration pretty clean, then those that can't stick around can always leave, and we can answer questions and answers as time allows after that. So I don't mind that at all, because I always assume that those that have to scoot out real quick can do so right after the demonstration. Cassie, does that help at all? So we've got the downward curve and another downward curve in the opposite side. So they're kind of meeting. So like if this is my center line, it's one is starting just to the left of center and the other is starting a bit to the right of center. So, oh, Barbara, thank you so much. I do try, because I want to equip you all to try this, because I know that there have been many times where ladies have said, oh, I'm not artistic, I'm not creative. And I want to encourage you that it's about more than just the artistry. It's about practice and breaking down into the strokes that are totally learnable. And then going and adding your style once you're comfortable with those. So hopefully that... You what? Which blue one? Okay. All right. Now we're going to get real squirrely with a toddler here. So, here's my little helper. She has shared her cold, so I am getting a little congested. So, with that said, that brings us to the end of learning new things with the calligraphy pen. Sorry. Oh, my tripod is done for the day, apparently. So, that's our clear. So, this weekend we have catch-up time. Look for other italic or calligraphy pen inspiration. Check out my Pinterest board for lettering and penmanship. Thank you. I have a bunch of different calligraphy alphabets on there, I think, things that I've pinned that I've found around the internet. And you'll find italic writing on a lot of different things as far as advertising or magazines and stuff go. It's one of the more common typesets that's used. And then next week, we're going to get started with brush lettering. I'm going to put a picture up on Instagram of the Fudenosuke pens for those that were wondering which pen we'll use. But for Monday, all you'll need is a pencil, because we're not going to use the brush pens until Tuesday. So I'll get that picture up. Those of you that join me at 9:30, I'll see you tonight. Otherwise, I will see you all on Monday. I hope you have a blessed weekend. Thanks.